and kindly introduce yourselves and tell us which organization you are representing. And we would like to reiterate one more time, like what Ma'am Ichu said a while ago, your help to like spread the word about the celebrations and events that we have lined up for you will be of great help, lalo na ito yung launching namin mismo. Yeah, so we would like to see how far all this goes para mas mapapalaki pa natin ang ating plataforma sa mga susunod na taon. There, so we are, the floor is now open for questions.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm MJ Balaguer of DCMJ Online. My question is to DOST PTRI Director. Kasi po, hindi ko napakinggan yung contribution. What is the contribution of DOST, especially the PTRI, on this month celebration of Philippine Creative Industry Month?
Magandang hapon po sa inyong lahat. On behalf of the DOST Secretary, may I convey some of our initiatives. So, for the Philippine Textile Research Institute in particular, we are technically on the last final leg of releasing the materials for the textile. This is related to the PCIM, ano po? The release of the textile bootcamp this month, but the end will be during the National Youth Science and Technology Fair in October. So this is also an initiative from Congress, which was also inserted in our budget, the DOSC budget last year. In particular po sa Philippine Textile Research Institute, we wanted to elevate the level of the knowledge of our TVET and senior high school students as far as their use, responsible, sustainable use of Philippine textiles. Kasi marami po, hindi po alam. So, yung iba, ginagawang table runner, yung loincloth ng Cordillera, for example, or ginagawa nating bolero, yung death blanket ng Abra. These are all some of the things that we sometimes overdo. And through this initiative, we wanted to raise the awareness of responsible use of Philippine textiles. At the same time, it's merging with our Philippine fashion industry. So, TVET and senior high school po yung tinatarget natin because the earlier we go, the better. Para po hindi lang ito about sketching and making, you know, new clothes, but also making them very, very aware of the creative and cultural value of this fabric. So that's one, the textile bootcamp. We are also launching this month the Bamboo Textiles PH. This is some of the new developments on the DOSC side. We were able to get textile fiber from bamboo. We are now just waiting for the IP protection before we open our mouth. Otherwise, baka mawala na naman po yung intellectual property sa atin. But technically, bamboo textile fiber, which can be used as part actually of the uniform for government. So there's also another law that mandates the use of Philippine textiles for our government uniforms, and that's the second one that we are also launching for this month. And yung pangatlo po is towards the end of the month, we are also holding the launch of the Philippine Handloom Weaving Conference, which is the technical arm of the Likha initiatives of Malacañang. And this one also provides us a better perspective of handloom weaving from the scientific and technological perspective. Maraming salamat po.
Thank you din po.
Thank you so much for that question. And thank you so much, Director Julius Leano, for that very insightful answer. I didn't know there were yung mga misuse ng textiles. And it's so hard to look for resources, actually, to educate ourselves on that. So it's good that you're going down to the
just,
high
yeah,
school.
Yeah, sundutin ko lang yun. Kasi mataas na rin po kasi ngayon yung ng issue ng counterfeiting of Philippine textiles. So it's also one that has caught the attention of Congress in the middle of the pandemic. Kasi yung Cordillera weaves po, tinatransfer na nila as prints. And then yung iba naman, nagpapanggap na woven textiles in the Philippines, but they are not. So only for trained eyes, you would see immediately, ah, hindi yan. Pero paano pag hindi trained yung eyes mo? And Filipinos are also very obsessed with cheaper fabrics. So napupunta po tayo dun sa trade na yon. And we wanted to stop that at the very onset. And this is part of our commitment as well with Congress, because the anti-counterfeiting part is also corrupting the industry as well. So these are part of the initiatives that we're trying to push. Maraming salamat.
Thank you po, sir. That's a very urgent issue indeed. And speaking of textiles, we also have, like right over on this side, there's a Tinalak weaving demo right there. So if you want to educate yourselves further and become an interactive activity, then po, you can visit this side of the booth. All right, so we have another question.
Good afternoon to our panelists. I'm EJ Gomez po from CNN Philippines. My question is for Kong de Venecia. Sir, you mentioned during your speech earlier that we need more investments for the Philippine creative industry because, in fact, investors are interested. We'd like to elaborate more on that. And, of course, the bigger question there is how exactly can the government develop the market for malikhaing produkto ng mga malikhaing Pinoy?
All right. I'm going to answer it initially and then I'm going to pass it on to you, Sekvita, because that's exactly what we were just talking about like 30 seconds ago. Yeah, so I am the Vice Chair of Appropriations and I'm defending the budget of DTI. So I've been sort of making myself more aware of all the programs and all of the successes and all the challenges. But I was so happy to see like one creative industry related investment approved by the Board of Investments. And of course, we need to amp up our investment promotions in this particular sector. I mentioned the MOU with Indonesia earlier. This was entered into by the Philippines and Indonesia just days after the first State of the Nation address of the President. And I had an opportunity to discuss this with Minister Sandiaga Uno of the Ministry of Tourism and Creative Economy at the Creative Economy Forum last year in Bali. And so this is something that we're looking forward to materializing to see how we can encourage more cooperation, not just within the bilateral relationship of Philippines and Indonesia, but also how to mainstream creative economy in the ASEAN. Through creating a technical working group, because this is really something that is an emerging economic sector within ASEAN, here in the Philippines, of course. When we commissioned that study with the Philippine Statistics Authority, we were so surprised with the figures that they were able to generate, while, of course, we're still firming up the methodology for capturing that information. But again, we need to educate our different investment promotions agencies on the different opportunities that await investors when they come to the Philippines to support the creative ecosystem in the country. Of course, that's the investment promotion agencies, and not to mention activation of the CREATE law and the incentives that await these locators and investors in the creative industries. Maybe you, Sekvita, can expound on that a bit more.
Yeah, thank you so much, Kong Toff, our creative champion, with our catalyst. Kung hindi talaga dun sa ginawa ni Kong Toff nung pandemic, imagine, no, he did all this work amid the pandemic. But going back to the question, in terms of how we're creating the markets to attract more investments, siguro, dadagdagan ko lang yung sinabi ni Kong Toff, we do a lot of promotion, especially now that there's really a huge demand, not only for outsourced creative activities, but the demand really is bigger for creative works, original content. And given the Malikhaing Pinoy program, given the PESIDA, really, yun yung crucial eh, as we create the environment that would enable us to build this capacity and be able to realize our objective, and that is to become Asia's creative hub in the very near future. So I was just telling Kong Toff about the recent festival where we participated. We had a booth together with FDCP, the Film Development Council of the Philippines, and we were able to generate sales of around $30 million, covering mga sales yon, mga co-production, and other funding. And at the same time, sumama din, we were bringing 10 animation companies who participated in a pitching competition. Maraming nag-attend dun sa Philippine booth. Marami tayong kasabay, pero napuno yung booth natin. And at the same time, there was also a Southeast Asian pitching competition organized there at ANSI. Tatlo naman yung companies natin that participated there. So it is through this participation in exhibitions and fairs abroad that we're able to demonstrate to the world kung ano yung capacities and capabilities, the creativity, and then yun nga, no, the fusion of technology, culture, and creativity here in the Philippines. And we're hoping that through all these initiatives and through our sustained efforts, we'll really be able, Kong Top, to realize yung mga goals that you mentioned earlier. If not, sana we'll be able to double in 2 years' time, in a short period of time. And that's how really yung Malikhaing Pinoy and the Pisida are really crucial in terms of achieving all of this. Hindi lang yung investments, but at the same time, through these investments, we're able to create not just any job, pero quality jobs.
Thank you, Yusek Aldaba. Going back, just two follow-ups po. Kong, you mentioned about the budget. For this year, we have 410 million pesos po, no? Can you cite lang po kung ano po yung mga aspect exactly, kung saan po matcha-channel initially itong 410 million pesos? And for next year, are we pushing for higher budget po for the creative industry?
Yes, so I believe the Young Creative Challenge is the 50 million. And then the 250 million was just recently downloaded to DTI by the DBM. And that's essentially the funding source for all of the Malikhaing Pinoy programs that were discussed earlier by DTI during the program. And then, of course, there is the 110 million that I believe will be downloaded sometime next year. The budget appropriations are usually valid for 2 years. And so at least we have seed capital for Malikhaing Pinoy for next year. Now we are in the process of deliberating the budget for 2024. And the initial allocation of the DBM to Malikhaing Pinoy is 50 million. As opposed to last year, it was zero. So for me, that's already a win that our economic managers recognize the value that creative industries bring to the table. Of course, it's now incumbent upon us in the lower house, in the Senate, to be able to raise the 50 million to at least at the same level or even higher, because really, what I failed to mention earlier in our message is that the goal is for the Philippines to be the number one creative economy in ASEAN by 2030. So it's now 2023. So we have 7 years to do that. So now we have a developmental framework in place because of the law. Now we just need the resources so that they can implement the different mandates of the law so that we can, you know, pump up and prime up our performance, especially in exports of our creative content. I said earlier, we are number one in ASEAN in exporting our creative services. Of course, we've always known that Philippines is a very service-oriented country. Our service is really, bar none, it's really the best, if not in ASEAN, in the entire world. But our creative goods are sort of middling because of so many different problems. Of course, high power rates, a weak or a struggling manufacturing base. We have logistics concerns. And then now, this creative industry law is an enabling mechanism for a whole of government approach to developing the sector and addressing the many different pain points that have been plaguing the different creative industry sectors for decades. If I may just share, I remember our hearings for the furniture and fashion industry, and they told us that it's more expensive to ship your furniture from Visayas or Cebu to NCR than to Singapore. So why is that? there are so many problems, and for the longest time, creative industry is super bottom in the priority list. So now we're just elevating the profile so more and more government agencies are able to actually allocate passion, energy, and action to solving these issues.
One last question po from the CNN Philippines. Anyone can answer po. Ibaba lang po natin dun para sa mga kapwa natin Pilipino, especially those involved or kabilang sa creative industry po dito sa bansa natin. What can our kababayans expect with this program po natin, and now that we have the law, and what's the future of creative industry in the Philippines?
Yes, for the Department of Tourism, on behalf of Secretary Cristina Frasco, we're very excited to be part of the Philippine Creative Industries Month, because for the longest time, our Secretary and of course the DOT has been championing tourism not only to be something that's consumed or experienced, but really more on co-created by not only our international tourists, but also our local tourists. So what we've been doing for the DOT side is to host for December, and of course there will be a pre-congress that will happen this September in line with the Philippine Creative Industries Month. Creative Tourism Summit, which will happen in December 6 to 9, wherein we'll be bringing experts from across the globe to teach our tourism officers, to teach our local government units in creating products that are more in tune with the Filipino spirit. No? It's not just about letting our tourists experience the Philippines by consuming it, but also by creating opportunities for them to co-create with the locals, to be more immersive, to be more participative in nature. So sa amin, yun yung gusto naming ibahagi as part of the creative industries. We want tourism to be more proactive in terms of creating opportunities for our locals and for our tourism stakeholders to create, to be co-creative with our guests, our foreigners, both and also for our domestic tourists.
Good afternoon, sir. For DICT, good afternoon, everyone. I'm happy to be here. So DICT is part of the council, and one of the missions of DICT is to ensure the growth and competitiveness of the ICT-enabled industries that will result to the creation of more jobs. So particular one ICT industry is creative industry. So yung question po kanina ng CNN Philippines is, how do we bring this to Filipinos, particular to the countryside? So one of the programs po is DICT is capacitating our locations, particularly we call that program Digital Cities. So what we do is we capacitate the stakeholders, the ecosystem in those cities, and even actually promoting, developing their cities as creative industry destination. And we have identified several cities, for example, Naga, Lawag, Baguio, and even Iligan as a creative industry destination. So particular programs that we do is doing advocacy programs, inviting, encouraging Filipinos, the students, to join the creative industry. And at the same time, part of our support for the many past years, working together with our, so I'm talking about digital creative kasi yun po yung mandate ng DICT, of course, aside from providing connectivity, so working closely with our industry partners, the Animation Council of the Philippines, and the Game Developers Association of the Philippines, and other sector associations that will really actually bring jobs, not only here in Metro Manila, but to the countryside in the name of creative industry.
Yeah, thank you, Kong Tof. Well, of course, what will it mean to the ordinary, to our to Juan or to Maria, no? And itong anong meaning itong ginagawa nating big promotion and developing, strengthening our creative industries? Well, for one, importante kasi na yung mga programa natin di lang naka-base dito sa NCR, but as earlier presented, we really want to create more creative cities, more creative regions. Kaya nandun yung Piesta Kutsa, nandun yung ating lungsod-lunsad, wherein nagbibigay tayo ng support sa mga LGUs natin, sa mga cities, as well as Kasama na din dito yung mga DTI regional offices, no? What we want really is for all these groups and stakeholders to work together and collaborate in developing and promoting yung creative industries dun sa specific area, no? This is really important in order for us to sustain yung contribution ng creative industries, which right now 7%, 1.6 trillion ng pesos worth yung contribution sa economy, and that's 7%, no, of the GDP, and at the same time almost 7 million workers. And what we, para ma-sustain natin ito, we need to continue reaching out down to the barangay level siguro, no? Gusto natin makasama lahat dito sa mga festivities and celebrations, the intent of which is really i-promote and create the awareness. Kasi minsan, ang mga magulang, di ba, nakikita nila na ay wala namang future dyan sa creative. But what we're trying to say is, meron kang career dito sa creative. Kaya nga, yung ginagawa natin ngayon, we're really trying to leverage on existing technologies. Yung fusion ng technology, creativity, and innovation, napaka-importante because ito yung magiging tool natin para mas marami pang mga industriya ang mag-emerge sa mga cities, in different regions, para yung mga trabaho na makikreate natin would really be high quality, no? High-paying jobs. Siguro kung ikokompara mo sa ibang services sectors, while of course, yun yung malaking contribution sa economy, pero in terms of the value added, maliit lang yon as compared sa isang sector like creative na nakaka-produce ka ng original content na talagang ang market, hindi lamang sa bansa, but including sa abroad. And we can feel that, siguro going back dun sa question kanina on investments, marami nang pumupuntang mga companies that are interested to invest here in the country. Kami naman sa BOI and DTI, we of course provide all the necessary support para matulungan itong mga companies na to, especially in terms of yung paghanap ng mga tamang tao. Pero at the same time, importante din kasi yung Creative Learning Academy na gagawin natin under the Malikhaing Pinoy para ma-nurture nating mabuti yung mga budding creative workers dito sa ating industriya.
Kung tough, can I? Yes, go ahead. Kami po naman sa Intellectual Property of the Philippines ay nakikisa po kami, no? DTI, at ganoon na rin po sa Development Council. Kaya isang message lang ni ADJD kagabi na may press con ngayon, nagmamadali pa po tayong umattend, no? Unang-una po, nandito po ang IPOFIL para po pangalagaan ang karapatan po ng ating mga kababayan sa intellectual property rights nila, no? Kaya kami po, pinag-iigting po namin yung mga improvements sa aming pong services sa pag-register po ng trademarks, copyright, patents, utility model, at industrial design, no? Pangalawa, development, meron din po kami development functions, no? Umiikot po kami sa buong Pilipinas para po i-brief po natin na ating mga creatives tungkol po sa karapatan nila, no? Kaya dahil po based po sa experience namin, marami po sa ating mga creatives ang hindi po nakakaalam kung ano po yung karapatan nila sa batas, no? Kaya patuloy po yan, at patuloy rin po kami nakikipag cooperate, sapagkat sabi nga po ni Kong Tof kanina, dapat whole of government approach, no? And hindi po, hanggat hindi po tayo nararamdaman ng ating mga kababayan Pilipino, hindi pa po tapos ang functions ng Development Council. Sa pamamagitan lang po ng pakikipagtulungan ng bawat isa sa atin, hindi lang po ng public sector, no, pati na rin po private sector, and I acknowledge the President of the International Council of Small Business, si Eric Paig, who is present here, na katulong po natin, pati rin po yung mga private sectors, no, lalong-lalo na po sa amin, sapagkat naniniwala po kami na hindi namin may encourage ang ating mga kababayan na magrehistro kung hindi po natin mapoprotektahan. Kaya isa pong function din po namin ay enforcement po, no? Lalong-lalo na po ngayon sa panahon ng pandemya na marami nag-online, so marami rin po mga kaso ng piracy na nakikita po natin ngayon, no? So dati po counterfeiting lang sa mga brick and mortar, sa mga tindahan, pero ngayon po naging komplikado na po ang sitwasyon, meron na rin po tayong mga kalaban sa online. Kaya yung pakikipagtulungan po natin hindi lamang po sa government agencies, kundi ganoon na rin po sa mga other private sector. Maraming salamat po.
And finally, I just wanted to add na maliban dun sa Philippine Creative Cities Network na salient feature ng batas, kung saan gusto natin i-empower yung mga local chief executives natin for creative governance at kung paano makakaresponde sa pangangailangan ng ating mga malikhaing Pinoy sa barangay, ay isa pang salient feature ng batas ay yung mga existing na mga negosyo center sa lahat ng LGU, gusto natin siya gawing one-stop shop para sa lahat ng mga creatives na gustong i-register ang kanilang mga produkto, ang kanilang mga negosyo at ma-avail yung mga serbisyo ng gobyerno. Kasi minsan talagang may karagatan sa pagitan ng creative sa barangay at yung mga batas na ganito na national government agency ang nagpapatupad. So at least man lang meron ng puntahan sa local level ang ating mga malikhaing Pinoy. At pangatlo, meron rin tayong section dun sa batas na kung tawagin ay Creative Education and Instruction, kung saan ang DepEd, CHED, at TESDA ay kailangan makipagtulungan sa ating mga malikhaing mga firm or kumpanya para mas ma-address yung pangangailangan ng mga kumpanya nung training na nangyayari sa ating mga educational and technical vocational institutions. Kasama rin sa batas yung pagbibigay ng scholarships, hindi lamang sa mga malikhaing kabataan, kundi dun sa mga malikhaing Pinoy na nakagraduate na gusto maghasa sa kanilang mga pinagkakabalahan or kanilang mga career. And of course, yung nabanggit din kanina sa presentation is yung suportahan yung mga non-formal learning modalities na meron tayo ngayon sa ating komunidad. Isa dyan ang mga museums. Dapat matulungan ang lahat ng museums sa ating bansa, privado ba niyan or pampubliko. Pangalawa, dapat matulungan ang lahat ng gumagawa ng mga webinar at ng mga online seminar na naglalayong makatulong sa ating mga creative workers at creative youth. Pangatlo, dapat makatulong ang malikhaing Pinoy sa ating mga Schools for Living Tradition na programa ng NCCA para yung ating malikhaing Pinoy ngayon, hindi nila makalimutan ang kanilang kultura at tradisyon, lalo na yung mga ngayon ay medyo naglalaho or medyo nagko-contract kasi hindi pumapasok or hindi na-appreciate ng ating malikhaing kabataan ang mga tradisyon na sinimula ng kanilang mga ninuno. And of course, support din sa mga creative residency programs, whether gobyerno man or pribadong sektor, ang nagpapatakbo because isang paraan ito parang creatives mula sa ibang lugar ay pumunta sa inyong sa inyong city or municipality para makapag-network, makapag-jamming, makapag-collaborate dun sa mga creatives dun sa inyong barangay para kumbaga nagiging mas kilala ang creatives sa barangay dun sa national or sa level ng national. So actually, marami pong mga programa ang Philippine Creative Industry Development Act na talagang mararamdaman at mapapakinabangan ng ating mga 7 million higit na malikhaing Pilipino.
All right, thank you so much to our panelists. Is there a follow-up question?
Yes po. Good afternoon po to everyone. So, we are part of the creative industry po. We are the organizer po of the Manila International Dance Festival, which will happen po on September 8 to 10 sa Rizal Park po. So, kami po ay nagsimula lang sa iba't ibang grupo na nag-usap about sa ideyang ito. And we are very surprised lang din when the counterparts from the other nation po is nagbigay ng kanilang commitment to be with us on this festival. So right now po, we have like 5 countries joining us. Then surprisingly, more than 20 groups from all over the Philippines po ang sasali for the festival. Bago lang po ang aming binuong grupo at medyo overwhelming po ang naging response din ng community. And we are very happy na naging part po kami ng PISIM celebration. Now, my question po is like sa aming mga grupo po na nagsisimula pa lang sa ganito na just to let you know lang po, ang dami po talagang magagaling creative people all over the Philippines na talagang suporta lang din po ang hinihintay. Nung una naglabas kami ng invitation to join the festival, marami po yung gustong sumali. But then along the way, ang naging challenge na sa kanila is of course yung expenses along the way, how they will be transported from their city going to the main venue and such, which is kami po being wala pa talaga kaming budget. Nag-depend lang po talaga kami sa sponsors, in-kind and services and products of the brands po na tinap namin. Ngayon, my question po, ano po kaya ang pwedeng maging participation po ng ating bagong programa para sa mga ganitong event initiated po ng hindi naman po talaga totally like a government agency or more of a private or a community group po?
Salamat sa tanong. Pwede po kayo na makipag-partner sa kung saan nakalocate yung inyong organization. Meron namang DTI regional office or sa mga DTI provincial offices. And then if you can work together, pwede rin pala, apart from DTI, dun sa LGU where you are, pwedeng work together kayo and craft a proposal. Siguro pwede yung pecha kucha dito, pwede rin lunsod-lunsad, kasi kung yun yung yung competitive advantage ng lugar, gusto nating i-highlight yun eh. Gusto nating matulungan at ma-market yung lahat ng mga activities na gagawin through yung proposal. Sana kailangan natin kasi yun yung pagmumulan nung klase ng support na pwede naming ibigay. Pwede po tayong mag-discuss siguro or if you can get in touch with one of the members of the team para we can help you in crafting the proposal. Yun po yung the best way by which we could work together with you. And yung pecha kucha, lungsod-lungsad, including yung Yang, unfortunately, walang dance yata doon sa doon sa Yang Creatives Challenge. But now that you're bringing it up, maybe doon sa next, sa next phase ng program, we can probably include that, pero that doesn't discount yung fact na you can come up with your own proposal and you submit it to us, we'll do the necessary evaluation and help you in terms of carrying out whatever mga activities that you would include in the proposal.
Yes po, actually we did the sending of letters, a proposal, and the letter of intent po with different agencies. Luckily, we had the commitment of the LGU of the City of Manila, the National Parks Development Committee. We also send letters with the Intramuros administrations. Ang naging challenge lang po namin, like for example, for like kay Kong Tof, is yung having the letter on the table, parang ganun po. So we send out already the proposal, such mga ano pa po, more than a month or two. Kaya po, parang yun lang po siguro yung avenue na hinahanap ng creative people like us, na parang paano po ba siya pwedeng, the proposal po is really part din po talaga ng planning and the whole process po. But yun lang po siguro yung challenge, yung parang hindi na malaman kung how can we really get in touch po doon sa right agency or office po.
Yeah, maybe we can also add on to that. We may not have a big budget as that of DTI, but the National Commission for Culture and the Arts is also offering grants, especially for organizations, for NGOs, for CSOs, in initiating programs for the promotion of the various sectors of the arts. Actually, the NCA cover a whole range of 19 different sectors, from arts to cultural education, to cultural heritage, and to the cultural communities and traditional arts. So there's really a wide range. And we open the call every from March to August of the year for the following year. So the schedule of our project call is usually a year ahead of its implementation, because we are aligning with the budgeting of the government. So I hope that next time we are just in Intramuros, if you are familiar with this area, or you can come here at the Met, you can ask for information. Because annually, we're providing grants to different organizations in the arts.
Okay, in response to your question, sir, first we need a roadmap for the performing arts as an industry. Because I work in the performing arts myself, and ang daming problema. And we're all just trying to do our best to mount our productions, festivals, and whatever. I mean, you have the Manila International Dance Festival, you have the theater productions there, you have the improv festival, and unlike the support that performing arts gets in countries like Europe, dito, it's very, very minimal, if at all, right? So first, we need to identify ano-ano ba yung problems. I think there are problems with labor insofar as yung bayad sa ating mga performers. Pangalawa, walang subsidies or hardly any subsidies na nanggagaling sa gobyerno. Yung mga theater productions sa London, sa UK, because of their arts councils of England, 50% ng revenue nila ay nanggagaling sa state subsidy. So kung magbe-break even ka at 50%, sa subsidy mo pa lang sa gobyerno, break even ka na. Yung ticket sales na mabibenta mo after that, bonus na yon, profit na yon. So obviously the value chain here for the performing arts is broken and something needs to be fixed. Third, if you are somebody who operates and organizes festivals, it's very possible na ma-subject din kayo sa amusement tax. Ang amusement tax ay pinapataw ng local governments, formerly 30%, now 10%. Not of net, ha? Of your gross. And so, hindi lahat ng LGUs are aware of the role that they play in the sustainability and productivity of the performing arts as an industry. Of course, meron din tayong marketing na talagang forever yan problema sa performing arts. Hindi lahat marunong mag-organize ng press con, or kung sino man ang i-invite nila sa press con, it depends kung may makakilala kang press, di ba? And then of course, yung paggamit ng social media sa pag-promote ng ating mga services, hindi lahat ng performing arts companies ay hasa or marunong sa ganyang aspeto. So, kailangan ng upskilling rin on the part of like stakeholders sa performing arts kung paano gamitin ang digital tools as well as kung paano mag-market ng ating mga goods and services. So, yung roadmap is a salient feature of the Creative Industry Law. Magsisimula na po yan, napasimula na initially ng NCCA, napondohan po natin yan. And then, kailangan ipagpatuloy para mas marami pang performing arts stakeholders ang sumali para malaman natin ano ba ang kailangan ng performing arts sector. Maliban sa roadmap, marketing support. So, we're very happy na itong PSEM, there's an enabling mechanism, yung QR code, para ma-promote ang inyong mga events. Kasi, of course, it's about awareness, it's about information na ang dami-dami ka-kompetensya, you're all fighting for attention from your audiences. And in fact, September, ang dami-daming productions na nangyayari dito sa NCR pa lamang. Of course, meron din sa ibang mga probinsya. So, kailangan mabigyan ng platform ang ating creative entrepreneurs like yourself, creative organizations, para ma-promote ang kanilang mga activities. It starts with PSEM. We're also in touch with the Presidential Communications Office to create a service to be able to extend to our creative organizations para magamit yung media assets ng gobyerno para mas ma-promote ang inyong mga event. Of course, kailangan rin ng mekanismo para ang private sector ay mahikayat at sumuporta sa performing arts. Kasi let's face it, no? Kung makakahanap kayo ng sponsor, baka maliit lang yung ibibigay kasi hindi naman ganong kamulat ang ating malalaking kumpanya sa ano ba ang nagagawa ng performing arts. Pero kung meron tayong incentive program sa kanila na suportahan ang mga organization tulad ninyo na magbigay ng substantial cash sponsorship or kahit ex-deal man lang kasi magagamit nila yon as tax deductible sa kanilang mga gastusin or sa pag-declare ng kanilang mga expenses sa kanilang kumpanya, at least may hikayat natin yung private, public-private partnership na kung tawagin para sa creative industries kasi hindi talaga kakayanin. Of course, you have the lungsod-lungsad. So, kung saan po ba kayo nakabase? Anong probinsya?
Manila po kami, sir.
Manila. So now, the Lungsod-Lunsad, si Mayor Honey Laguna, can actually apply for that city grant in behalf of an organization like yourself. Para mabigyan kayo ng subsidy or ng grant para mas ma-organize nyo better ang inyong future Manila International Dance Festivals. Pero I was just talking to Yusek Fita. I think what we need to work on sa Malikhaing Pinoy is a grant program for the private sector. Yung didiretso na yung private sector dun sa DTI mag-apply. But again, we have to remember, ang KPI ng creative industry ay trabaho, kita, investment, export, intellectual property, meaning dapat may original content tayong ginagawa at marehistro natin yan sa IPOFIL. Of course, pag-develop at pag-grow ng audience. So most likely, kung magkakaroon tayo ng grant program for the private sector sa DTI, kailangan na i-hit natin yung mga indicators na yon. Kasi dyan natin na may measure kung successful ba si creative industry or hindi. Otherwise, you have the NCCA. Of, unfortunately, natapos na yung deadline for the competitive grants sa National Endowment Fund for Culture and the Arts, or yung NEFCA. Pero sana, paghandaan nyo na next year na makapag-apply kayo and you can get a substantial grant from the NCCA na iba naman ang kanilang indicators or outcomes. Not necessarily na kailangan kumita or kailangan na makapag-generate ng revenue, kasi importante rin na mabigyan kayo ng platform para makapag-create ng content na not necessarily kailangan natin isubject to the cash economy at dapat creative industry mechanisms or outcomes. So iba rin yung criteria ng grant ng NCCA. Siguro we can work on adding more budget to the grants program of NCCA para mas maraming matulungan ng mga creative workers na not necessarily kailangan kumita or kailangan, you know, ma-subject yung kanilang output to these same indicators of creative industry.
Thank you so much, Kong Toff.
Thank you, yeah. Kong Toff. Lastly, I would just like to re-promote lang po the Manila International Dance Festival. It will be joined by more than 400 performers all around the Philippines po. Maraming salamat
we
po.
We look forward to that. Yes, and maybe so. It'll be better if you can personally approach our panelists later on to fully help your initiative. Thank you so much, po.
And we'd love to collaborate with you for our Galila Arts Festival in Dagupan.
Yes, sir.
Next year. Kasi, again, if you approach different politicians for support, obviously we prioritize our constituents. So, but I would love to support you if you are to involve yourselves in our Galila Arts Festival in Dagupan. Thank you.
And that's right. Thank you.
Thank you. Finally, we have our last question from IBC 13.
Magandang araw po, panels. JB Santiago po from IBC 13. Mabilis lang po. Doon po sa 9 domains or creative sectors po natin, alin po doon yung mas binibigyan po natin ng focus?
Can you repeat your question?
Sorry. Out of those 9 domains ng creative sectors or creative industries, alin po yung mas binibigyan natin ng focus?
Oh, I don't think DTI can discriminate. All of those 9 creative industries need to be given the same passion, energy, prioritization, and resources because they all contribute. Admittedly though, in the Philippine Statistics Authority study, there are some domains na mas nagko-contribute dun sa 1.6 trillion. But the goal nga is for us to have a creative economy and nobody should be left behind. So to your question, sir, lahat kailangan bigyan ng focus.
Okay. Bale, ibig sabihin po nun, same po yung budget per domain?
Kasi I think the budget right now is in those programs that were presented by DTI. So sa Lungsod-Lunsad, syempre the LGUs will apply for a creative grant for something na strength ng kanilang syudad. So if you're Baguio, ang strength mo is craft and folk art. If you're Cebu, your strength is design. And then if you're Iloilo, your strength is gastronomy. So, iba-iba yung strength. Kami sa Dagupan, kung mag-apply kami, siguro ang strength namin is yung aming gastronomy kasi ang icon namin sa Dagupan is bangus, di ba? So, hindi mo rin talaga masasabi. Pero I think ngayon na merong satellite account sa creative industries na partnership ng DTI at ng Philippine Statistics Authority, at least na may measure na natin yung value at contribution ng bawat isang sector sa ating creative economy. May 2022 data na kaka-release pa lang nitong March. Etong taon na to, magkakaroon ng data gathering. Given these interventions that are coming from whole of government, we'll see kung paano tumaas or bumaba ang contribution ng bawat isang sector. Pero I think ang importante is, as soon as ma-organize na yung Creative Industry Council in compliance with the law, of course, yung ex-officio members natin, very active, pero kailangan ma-appoint na ni President ang ating private sector representatives to the council. As soon as maging regular na yung meetings, kailangan nilang i-operationalize na yung roadmap for the creative industries because we need a short, medium, and long-term plan. And at least in the short term, we can identify ano yung mga immediate problems na kailangan nating tutukan, ano yung immediate solutions na kailangan nating pondohan, at paano natin malaladder up lahat ng mga ito towards the 2030 goal of being the number one economy in ASEAN. So medyo nakakalula siya, pero I think everybody is determined to help realize that creative future, especially for our Filipino youth and our malikhaing Pinoy.
Okay po. Next po is, yun, isa sa mga paraan na PCIM is yung mga contests or competitions. Magkakaroon din po ba ng future project intended naman for students? Kasi mahilig din sila sa mga divisional, regional, national contests.
Shock, sorry, I'm hogging the mic. Yes, actually, the Young Creative Challenge is primarily geared towards students. And I think Dr. Lillian might be able to answer that question more thoroughly since sila yung nagpapatakbo ng program. But a lot of the programs of the creative industry, Malikhaing Pinoy, are actually geared towards providing opportunities for our learners. Even yung nabanggit ko kanina, yung support to non-formal learning, at saka yung scholarships para sa students, all of that is part of the equation. Now, it's just a matter of coming up with a roadmap para at the soonest possible time, meron na tayong plan. Kasi ngayon, ang dami nangyayari. So, kailangan step by step para ma-achieve natin ang ating end goal. But Dr. Lillian.
Thank you, Kong Tof. Of course, talaga naka-focus, lalo na yung YC2 natin. Gusto natin na next generation ng creatives ay mapasa talaga sa among the youth. So, alam naman natin marami tayong potential like game development. Nandyan yung mga strength na talaga sa bata mo makikita. And of course, magandang pagkakataon to para lalo natin mapagyaman ang ating mga creative industries.
Last question na lang po. Ano na lang po yung, yeah, quick lang po, message nyo po para sa mga kababayan po natin na inclined na sa creative industries at sa mga interested or gustong pumasok sa creative industries. Short message lang po. Kay Kong Tof na lang po. Okay.
Sorry, I'm hogging the mic. Ano yung message natin? So, obviously, the goal here is really for a creative future. And what do we mean by creative future? A future in which creativity is front and center to our daily lives. And a future where our creative youth will be empowered rather than discouraged to join the creative sector because of age-old mindsets or paradigms na walang pera sa sining or mahirapan ka kung pumasok ka sa sector na yan. It's so not the case as proven by other countries where there is more significant priority and support being given by their governments and as well as by their private sector to their creative workforce. So siguro yung mensahe ko sa ating mga malikhaing Pinoy ngayon is sana na-excite na kayo dahil parang yung ating creative future is already upon us. Ginagawa na natin ang paraan para mas maging sustainable ang pagkakaroon ng career sa pagiging isang malikhaing Pinoy. Pero it's not to say na wala rin silang responsibility or wala rin silang counterpart dun sa mga ginagawa ng gobyerno ngayon. One, kailangan nilang manatiling vigilant, kailangan nilang manatiling engaged. Diba? For example, sa usapin ng budget, lahat ng mga malikhaing Pinoy natin, dapat sumusulat sila sa kanilang mga congressman para suportahan ang budget ng malikhaing Pinoy. Dapat sumusulat din sila sa kanilang mga senator para bigyan ng karampatang pondo ang malikhaing Pinoy. Dapat nakikipag-engage sila sa kanilang local chief executive, yung mayor. Dapat pinapaintindi nila sa kanilang mayor or even sa kanilang barangay captain kung ano ba ang kahalagahan ng kultura at ng pagiging malikhain sa komunidad at sa pagbibuild ng ating nation or nation building na kung tawagin. They have to remain steadfast. And then also, and this is my personal advocacy, kaya yung isa ko pang bill na pinaglalaban ngayon is yung ating freelance protection bill. Kasi karamihan ng workforce sa creative industry ay freelance na kung tawagin. Na very, very vulnerable ang ating freelancers as sa kabayaran, sa hindi sila binabaya, tinatakbuhan sila ng mga kliyente nila, all of these usual heartaches that you hear from the freelance sector. So, while we're advocating for this freelance protection bill na sana maging batas this year, nakabinbin siya sa Senado, so hopefully DOLE and the Senate can work together because this is a priority of the President, which he mentioned in his first State of the Nation address. We need to protect our freelancers. Sana rin makapag-rehistro sa DTI ang ating mga creative entrepreneurs at ang ating mga creatives. Because kung kayo ay rehistrado, kayo ay mabibilang sa mga serbisyo at tulong na nanggagaling mula sa pamahalaan. Okay? So it's important that creative workers can register themselves as a solo proprietor or a solo corporation or as part of a company or a corporation with 5 incorporators. It's important that yung creatives natin ay makakuha ng mga resibo mula sa BIR kasi nagagamit nila yung resibong iyan para mas makapag-apply for a visa, para mas ma-hire sila ng mga kumpanya kasi yung kumpanya hinahanap yung resibo. Kung walang resibo yung creative worker, eh saan nila ilalagay yung expense nila sa'yo or pag-contract nila ng services mo. And then of course, para makapag-loan din sa mga formal lending institutions and government financial institutions. So I think it's important that as creatives, we also do our share also with registering with our different government entities because that's the only way in which we will be better protected. And it's not like ayaw ng mga creatives natin na mag-formalize into the economy. Sometimes, ang nagiging stumbling block is yung information, yung awareness, at saka yung capacity to be able to do just that. Kasi kung kukuha ka ng accountant, medyo mahal siya. Or 5,000, 10,000, kung nagsisimula ka pa lamang. But because of all these laws that we have passed from Train 1, technically, if you're a starting creative earning 21,000 pesos and below, you're exempt from paying income.